This is part 4 of a series on recurrent neural networks. In this video, we will look at long short-term memory, LSTM. This video was produced in Korean and translated into English. My voice is generated by AI, text-to-speech. In the last 3 videos, we looked at simple RNN. It struggles to learn long-term dependencies because of vanishing or exploding gradients. That is, it is difficult to learn information from the distant past simply by increasing the number of time steps. The LSTM was designed to address the problem. In this video, we will briefly look at the history and papers of LSTM, and then take a closer look at the structure of LSTM. And let's take a look at how backpropagation works in LSTM and how it solves the vanishing and exploding gradient problems that occur in simple RNNs. The structure of a simple RNN is like this. The gradients of HT with respect to WH are backpropagated like this. At first, this much is backpropagated, and then all of these gradients are combined and backpropagated. When I is T-1, this part becomes FH prime. But when I is 1, this part becomes W to the power of T-2. Therefore, if W is less than 1 and T is long, the backpropagated gradient becomes very small. That is, as backpropagation progresses, this size becomes exponentially smaller. To solve this problem, many studies have been actively conducted since 1990. According to the abstract of this paper, Sepp Hochreiter and Jürgen Schmidhuber briefly reviewed Hochreiter's 1991 analysis of this problem, then addressed it by introducing a novel, efficient, gradient-based method called long short-term memory, LSTM. At that time, LSTM had a structure consisting of cell states and input and output gates. In 1999, Felix Gerst et al. Added a forget gate to the existing LSTM through this paper. To improve the weakness of LSTM, their remedy is a novel adaptive forget gate that enables an LSTM cell to learn to reset itself at appropriate times, thus releasing internal resources. Its role is to reset previous memories and learn new flows when a flow of data unrelated to the previous flow comes in. The LSTM widely used today is Felix Gerst's 1999 version with the addition of a forget gate. Since then, many variations of LSTM have been developed. For example, peephole LSTM, GRU, etc. have been proposed, and convolutional LSTM has also been proposed. Peephole LSTM and GRU will be discussed in part 6 of this series, and convolution LSTM will be discussed later in the CNN series. Now let's look at the structure of LSTM. In a traditional RNN, this process is repeated while passing the hidden state H to the next time step. In LSTM, a cell state C is added here, and this is also passed to the next time step along with H. The figure below details the internal structure of one time step. This is the basic structure of a LSTM cell. The previous hidden state HT-1 is entered into this cell, and HT is passed to the next time step. Similarly, the previous cell state C of T-1 is also input into this cell, and CT is passed to the next step. An LSTM cell consists of a forget gate, an input gate, a candidate memory, and an output gate. It consists of four blocks as follows. Input data X is fed into each block. The X is a N by M matrix. N is the batch size of the input data. And M is the number of features. The structure of the input data is the same as that of the existing RNN, and we will look at this in more detail later. And the previous hidden state HT-1 is also fed into each block. Each block has trainable parameters W that are multiplied by XT, and trainable parameters R that are multiplied by HT-1. Each gate has its own unique W called WF, UI, WC, and WO. And each gate also has RF, RI, RC, and RO. In the forget gate, XT.WF plus HT-1.RF plus bias are computed. And then the sigmoid activation function is applied to the result. This is FT, the output of the forget gate. If we express this as a formula, it is as follows. Multiply FT by CT-1 and pass the result to the next. In this way, the output of each block is computed, and HT and CT are passed to the next time step. H and C are N by P matrices respectively. P is the number of neurons in the hidden or recurrent layer. The W's are each M by P matrices, and the R's are each P by P matrices. F is a M by P matrix, and H.RF is also M by P matrix. Bias BF is a 1 by P matrix. Therefore, the output F of the forget gate is a N by P matrix. This symbol is element-wise product. This is the currently widely used LSTM cell structure. Next, let's look at the role of each gate. The forget gate controls how much of the previous cell state information is passed on to the next time step. The output of the forget gate is FT. FT times CT-1 is passed to the next. Since the activation function of the forget gate is sigmoid, FT is between 0 and 1. If FT is 0, the forget gate is closed. That is, the cell state is reset. Then the LSTM completely forgets the past memories. If FT is 0.5, only 50% of CT-1 is passed. And if FT is 1.0, 100% of CT-1 is passed to remember all the past memories. The candidate memory uses the current input data X and the previous hidden state H of T-1 to determine new information. This is C tilde. And the input gate determines how much of the new information C tilde will be stored. Here, the output of the input gate IT is multiplied by C tilde. Since the activation function of the input gate is also sigmoid, the output is a value between 0 and 1. If IT is 0, the C tilde is considered meaningless information and is not stored. If IT is 1, the C tilde is considered important information and is stored 100%. That is, if the new information is important, the value of I increases to store more information. If it is not important, the value of I decreases to store less information. FT times CT-1 plus IT times C tilde is passed on to the next. This is the CT that is passed to the next time step. The formula for calculating CT is as follows. This symbol is the element-wise product. The output gate determines the size of the next hidden state value. Multiply the hyperbolic tangent of CT by OT and pass the resulting HT to the next time step. Let's look at the formula for calculating CT again. C of T minus 1 is the past information and C tilde is the current new information. And both F and I are between 0 and 1. This formula is similar to computing a weighted average of two types of information using F and I. It decides how much of the past information to forget and how much of the new information to store, and passes it on to the next time step. Next, let's look at how data is fed into the LSTM. The structure of the dataset is identical to that of existing RNNs. This is the dataset for a many-to-one RNN model that we looked at in the first video of this series. And this is for time series forecasting. For more information, please refer to this video. This is a many-to-one LSTM model. Like a traditional RNN, the LSTM layer repeats for a given number of time steps, T. To make this easier to understand, we unfold it into T time steps. The cell structure at each time step is as follows. Only the structure within each time step has changed from the existing RNN, and the way of feeding data is completely the same as the existing RNN. In this example, the time step size is set to 5. The first subset consists of 5 data points numbered 1 to 5. This is the first subset, X1. The superscript is the subset number. And the second subset consists of 5 data points, numbered 2 to 6. Feature X has a 3-dimensional structure. The first dimension is the number of subsets, which is the batch size that will be fed into the LSTM. The second dimension is the number of time steps, i.e. the number of sequences. And the third dimension is the number of features. In this example, the target has a 2-dimensional structure. The first dimension is the number of subsets, i.e. the batch size. And the second dimension is the number of LSTM outputs. In order to predict the time series of each feature, it becomes the number of features. Let's assign a superscript to each data point. For example, this is the second feature value of the third time step of the first subset. We denote it like this. The subscript is the feature number. The first superscript is the subset number, and the second is the time step number. Now let's feed the above data into this LSTM. Data points in the first subset are fed into the input layer at each time step. We feed the data points in the first row of the first subset into the first time step. The data input to each step is a n by 2 matrix. N is the batch size, and 2 is the number of features. Then we feed the data points in the second row into the second time step. And the data points from the next subset are fed into the input layer at each time step. This is a batch data. The outputs of the recurrent layer of the first time step, H1 and C1, are fed into the second time step like this. At the next time step, the outputs of the recurrent layer are also fed into the next time step. In this way, the outputs of each step are propagated to the last time step. This way, all the past information will be available in the final time step. In other words, it learns the dependencies of time series in a subset. At the first time step, the initial values 0 are fed since there are no previous recurrent outputs. The outputs of the recurrent layer at the last time step, H5, are fed into the output layer. The parameters W and R in each gate of LSTM are 2 by P matrices. 2 is the number of features, and P is the number of neurons in the recurrent layer. Then the output H5 of the final time step becomes a N by P matrix. And the parameter WY of the output layer is a P by 2 matrix. Therefore, the output Y hat of the output layer becomes a N by 2 matrix. This has the same dimension as the target data Y. And then we compute the loss using the outputs of the output layer and the target data. As the gradients of the loss are backpropagated, all the parameters are updated. Next, let's look at the backpropagation through time BPTT of LSTM. The BPTT of a traditional RNN is like this. This is covered in detail in this video. The gradient of H with respect to WH is backpropagated through time like this. If we compute this gradient, the results are as follows. And this part can be written as follows. WH is updated by this amount at time step T, and by this amount at other time steps. Since WH is common to all time steps, if it is less than 1, the gradient will always vanish. Now let's look at the BPTT in LSTM. The gradient of loss with respect to each parameter is backpropagated through two paths, C and H. The cell state is propagated through this path without going through any networks. This is similar to the highway connections or residual connections we looked at in detail in this video. When gradients are backpropagated, they are smoothly backpropagated along this path. And this gradient is also backpropagated downwards and combined with this gradient. Similarly, this gradient is also backpropagated upwards and combined. Now let's look at this in a formula. Let's look at the gradient of C with respect to WF. Like the RNN above, this can be written as follows. And this part can be written as follows. CT is a function of the FT, IT, and CT tilde, each of which is a function of CUT minus 1. This is the result obtained through the multivariate chain rule. This can be written as follows. These are multiplied many times over. Even if WF is less than 1, WI or WC can be greater than 1. The opposite is also true. In RNNs, this value is always less than 1 or always greater than 1, but in LSTMs, this is not always the case. Therefore, it is much less likely to have vanishing or exploding gradients compared to RNN. This is the advantage of LSTM. For more information, please see this article. So far, we have looked at the structure of LSTM, the role of each gate, and BPTT. In the next video, we will implement an LSTM model for time series prediction.